मीनाक्षी माउर, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर जूलॉजी, श्री सांवला जी गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज, मंडफिया, चित्तौड़गढ़। टुडे आई विल एक्सप्लेन हाउ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड इज ट्रांसपोर्टेड फ्रॉम टिश्यू टू एल्वोलाई इन ब्लड। सो ट्रांसपोर्ट ऑफ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड इन द ब्लड फ्रॉम टिश्यू टू लंग्स अकर्स इन अ थ्री वेज। फर्स्ट इज डिजॉल्व इन सॉल्यूशन, सेकेंड इज बफर्ड विथ वाटर एज अ कार्बनिक एसिड, एंड थर्ड इज बाउंड टू प्रोटीन, पर्टिकुलरली हीमोग्लोबिन। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई एक्सप्लेन हाउ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड ट्रांसपोर्ट्स फ्रॉम टिश्यू टू एल्वोलर सरफेस और लंग इन ब्लड प्लाज्मा। बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स हाई सोल्यूबिलिटी, बिकॉज ऑफ हाई सोल्यूबिलिटी ऑफ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड, अबाउट 5 to 7% कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड गेट डिजॉल्व इन अ ब्लड प्लाज्मा एंड कैरीड इन सॉल्यूशन टू द लंग। द अमाउंट ऑफ गैस डिजॉल्व इन लिक्विड डिपेंड्स अपॉन इट्स सॉल्युबिलिटी एंड द पार्शियल प्रेशर ऑफ गैस। यू कैन सी दिस इज आर द टिश्यू एंड कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड इज मूविंग फ्रॉम टिश्यू टू ब्लड प्लाज्मा। The partial pressure of carbon dioxide of venous blood is 45 mmHg, and it is about 40 mmHg in arterial blood. So about 0.3 ml of carbon dioxide can be carried to the lung in this way. The partial pressure of carbon dioxide is higher in the periphery, where tissue produces carbon dioxide, but the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is lower at the alveoli, where carbon dioxide is being released. And this differences in partial pressure allows more carbon dioxide to be dissolved in a periphery, while it is released in the gas phase in the alveoli, where the partial pressures are lower. So this is how blood plasma carries carbon dioxide from tissue to the alveoli surface. Now second is carbon dioxide is transported from tissue to the alveoli surface as a bicarbonate ion. So majority of carbon dioxide molecule, that is about 70%, are carried as a part of bicarbonate buffer system. Carbon dioxide comes to blood or diffuses in the RBC, red blood cells. In RBC, there is one enzyme, that is carbonic anhydrase. So it is a zinc containing enzyme and it is present within the RBC. It quickly converts the carbon dioxide into carbonic acid. Soon after the formation of carbonic acid, that is H2CO3, the carbonic acid gets dissociate into H plus and bicarbonate ions. Then the bicarbonate ions are highly permeable through RBC, and so they are expelled out of the RBC into the blood plasma. In blood plasma, this bicarbonate combined with sodium ion to form sodium bicarbonate. But in order to maintain the electrical neutrality, the same number of chloride ion are diffused into the RBC. And this exchange or shifting of chloride ion for bicarbonate ion is called chloride shift. This is also known as Gibbs-Danone equilibrium or hamburger effect. So this is about how exchange of chloride and bicarbonate ion takes place here. So but when the blood reaches the lung here, the bicarbonate ion is transported back into the RBC, again in exchange for chloride. The H plus ion dissociates from hemoglobin and binds to bicarbonate and produces carbonic acid intermediate, okay, which is converted back into carbon dioxide and water through the enzymatic action of carbonic anhydrase. And this carbon dioxide is expelled through the lung during exhalation. This is a reaction when carbon dioxide and water get mixed, it forms carbonic acid and it can dissociates into HCO3, it is a bicarbonate, and hydrogen ion. Again, H2CO3 gets dissociates into carbon dioxide and water with the help of enzyme carbonic anhydrase. So this is the process how transport of carbon dioxide occurs as a bicarbonate ion. Here I want to explain one more thing, that carbon dioxide is largely responsible for the dissociation of oxyhemoglobin. Higher the concentration of carbon dioxide, greater will be the dissociation of oxyhemoglobin. Or we can say that increased concentration of carbon dioxide helps the cell to acquire more oxygen. This effect is known as Bohr effect. I'll explain Bohr effect in detail in later slide. Now, third, transport of carbon dioxide as carbamino compound. So about 20 to 23% of carbon dioxide which enters into erythrocyte and combines with amine radical of globin part of hemoglobin and forms carbamino hemoglobin. Binding to carbon dioxide to hemoglobin is reversible. Hence, when it reaches the lung, the carbon dioxide can freely dissociate from the hemoglobin and be expelled from the body. So this is how carbaminohemoglobin is formed. This is hemoglobin and this is carbon dioxide bound to the hemoglobin. Now, what are the reasons for the release of carbon dioxide? So first is carbon dioxide is less soluble in arterial blood than in venous blood. Then second is Haldane effect. Actually, oxyhemoglobin behaves as a strong acid. It is slightly acidic in nature and therefore it usually remains combined with hemoglobin. As more or more oxyhemoglobin is formed in the lung, it releases more H plus ion and it in turn decreases the pH of blood. But the release of H ion combined with HCO3 ion and forms H2CO3, which in turn gets dissociates into carbon dioxide and water in presence of carbonic anhydrase enzyme. So this is Haldane effect. Third reason is that when there is a high partial pressure of oxygen, it favors the separation of carbon dioxide from carbaminohemoglobin. So these are the reasons which are responsible for release of carbon dioxide. Now I'll explain Bohr effect. According to this effect, partial pressure of carbon dioxide is inversely proportional to the concentration of HbO2. Means when partial pressure of carbon dioxide is high, the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen decreases and it therefore allows dissociation of HbO2 increase. So we can say that HbO2 dissociation curve will shift to right when CO2 is increased. So here you can see Well, this is a graph. Here, the y-axis showing percentage saturation of hemoglobin, and the x-axis showing partial pressure of oxygen in mmHg. So here you can see at the normal plot, means when partial pressure of carbon dioxide is about 40 mmHg. So this is a normal curve. But when the partial pressure of carbon dioxide increases, that is about 80 mmHg, then this normal curve shifts to right. Means the curve shifting to right occurs with increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Here you can see when there is a low partial pressure of carbon dioxide, the normal curve shifts to left with decrease in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. So this is Bohr effect. Now what is difference between Bohr effect and Heldon effect? So Bohr effect, Heldon effect describes that how oxygen concentration determines hemoglobin's affinity for carbon dioxide, while the Bohr effect describes how carbon dioxide and H plus ion affect hemoglobin affinity for oxygen. So the amount of carbon dioxide transported affected by partial pressure of oxygen. So today I explain how carbon dioxide transports in blood from tissue to lungs. It occurs in three ways. First is it dissolved in plasma or in solution. Then second, it transports as a bicarbonate ion, and third as a carbaminohemoglobin. So this is about carbon dioxide dissolved in blood plasma. This is how carbon dioxide buffered with water as a carbonic acid, and this carbon dioxide moves as a bicarbonate ion from tissue to alveoli. Then carbaminohemoglobin, how carbon dioxide binds to plasma protein and enter the blood plasma and bind to hemoglobin, and when it occurs, it forms carbaminohemoglobin. Then I explain what are the reasons behind release of carbon dioxide. So most important is a Heldon effect. Then what is Bohr's effect? And this is a graph which is showing Bohr effect. It is all about transport of carbon dioxide from tissue to alveoli. Thank you.